Part 2. The Cost of a Whim. Chapter 1. Forgotten? Quote, "It was divided into many squares or courts, according to the rank of those for whom they were designed. This house was built as if suspicion herself had dictated the plan." End quote. Rasselas, Chapter 1. The mild blue sky was covered with the most delightful little fleecy clouds in motion. Raoul de Sablière, his head tilted back against the 8-feet-high palisade of the officer's enclosure at Norman Cross, watched them rather abstractedly. One seemed to be outstripping the others. He wondered how long it would take to traverse the great camp, and what it saw as it sailed over the heads of more than 5,000 prisoners. He knew pretty well, although, as an officer, he was confined to one small section of the town. For Norman Cross Depot, though set in the middle of fields, was almost a town. For a moment or two, Raoul idly imagined himself voyaging on the cloud over Yaxley or Stilton Barracks. The prison was rich in these three names. Now, he was poised above the octagonal wooden blockhouse in the center, with its projecting guns dominating each of the four courts, or airing grounds, which so symmetrically surrounded it. Each court a couple of acres in extent, and each containing four blocks of wooden buildings placed side by side at one of the outer edges. Every block was calculated to hold 500 men, but in the northeastern court, three had been taken over as a hospital, and, of those in the southeastern, the endmost facing east was the officer's prison, in the small separate enclosure of which the imaginary voyager sat at this moment. The two English militia regiments on guard were quartered outside the walls altogether. Raoul and his cloud would, he knew, see a good deal of activity going on in those 42 acres, and more especially in the 22 of the prison proper. There, misery and cheerfulness, improvidence and industry jostled each other daily, for while some of the prisoners persistently gambled away not only their clothes and their bedding, but even their rations, others turned out little articles of beautiful workmanship in straw, bone, or paper, of which they were able to dispose at the market regularly held at the eastern gate. One object alone they might not legally manufacture and sell, straw plaid, so that highly paid commodity was generally smuggled out by soldier accomplices. It was Saturday, the 1st of May, and Raoul had now been for nearly 6 weeks a member of this captive population. His immediate companions, with a very few exceptions, were all broke paroles, like himself. Raoul had come by now, on the surface, almost to class himself as one, but underneath there was still the same indignant repudiation of the stigma. At first he had kept somewhat aloof from the other officers, until he saw that his attitude was resented, until he was, in fact, asked rather roughly what he had to give himself airs about, and had bitterly put the same question to himself. For the first month at Norman Cross, he had been sustained by the hope that when Miss Forrest returned to Wanfield, she would discover his absence, realize her share in the disaster which had befallen him, and set about having the injustice righted. Even if she had told the untruth attributed to her, surely, when she discovered what it had involved for him. In his very uncomfortable and depressing detention in the lockup at Wanfield, he had been strongly visited by the temptation to write directly to her and ask her whether she had declared that she had returned from Northover by the high road. But that would have been to force her hand. It was practically begging her to save him at whatever cost to herself. And it was of small use to be quixotic, if he had been quixotic, in the semi-publicity of Mr. Bannister's office, if, at the first taste of the consequences of his attitude, he was going to cry for mercy. So, the letter was never written, though another one was. But, though he would not put pressure upon her, Mr. Rowell might legitimately hope that Miss Forrest would, of her own free will, take some action on his behalf. Yet the days stole on, monotonous and unpleasant, and nothing happened. He was forgotten. Just one more broke parole. Raoul was not, however, of the temper to spend his time idly brooding over his situation, and from the first moment of his entry into Norman Cross, his dominant idea had been how to get out again. And at last, after weeks of planning, there seemed a chance of realizing this ambition. It was true that in the 16 years of its existence as a war prison, for which it had been specially built, very few captives had succeeded in escaping from the depot. But chance had thrown Raoul into close contact with two others as determined as himself to get away. A certain Lieutenant Clary of the 26th of the line, and a Captain Dumont, commander of a Saint-Malo privateer, the Indienne. The shortage of accommodation in the officers' quarters at the moment of his arrival had caused Raoul to be thrust at night into the cupboard. It was scarcely more, which was inhabited by these two men, and in this proximity was hatched the scheme to which that very proximity had given rise. The first problem was that of procuring 3 suits of civilian clothes. This, with the greatest difficulty, they had succeeded in doing. The next was that of getting undiscovered out of caserne number 8, the officers' block. Their tiny sleeping apartment had no proper window, but there was a ventilator in the roof, and this could be gained by an active young man assisted by his friends, and the same young man, at the cost of abrasions, could just squeeze himself through it and enlarge the exit by removing portions from outside. For the last 3 nights, Raoul had been working away at this task, and on Monday, the 3 adventurers counted upon scrambling out of this aperture and then climbing down in the dark as best they could into the enclosure. They had already contrived to bore a few small holes in the high stockade, and into these, when the moment came, they intended to thrust some long nails to give them a foothold. But since it was out of their power previously to approach and prepare the great brick wall which surrounded the prison, they had to trust to aid from its other side. Cautious negotiations, conducted by the English-speaking Raoul with a venal sentry of the West Kent militia, then on duty there, had resulted in the agreement that on the Monday night, the latter, being on guard outside near the south gate, should throw a rope over the wall, fastening it to some projection or other at its foot. Once over, and if they had the luck not to be seen by a sentry on the farther side, the fugitives could easily find their way to the Peterborough Road, which practically bordered the camp on the south. Thereafter, trusting to their wits, they must make either for the shores of the Wash or for the northern coast of Norfolk. They had a rather pathetic faith that, once arrived at the sea, Dumont, as a master mariner, would find some means of conveying them over that element. Raoul's cloud was gone now, melted into the blue. But that did not grieve him, for he had already forgotten about his aerial journey. A young man a few years his senior had detached himself from the groups strolling about the enclosure and was coming towards him in a purposely nonchalant manner. It was Lieutenant Clary. He sat down on the bench by his fellow conspirator, who affected to take little notice of his arrival. "How you look just now, as if you were trying to learn the stars by daylight," observed the newcomer jestingly, and then, lowering his voice, "Oh, I expect they're all we shall have to steer by. I can't get hold of a compass anywhere." Raoul just glanced at him without removing his head from its resting place against the stockade. "Oh, the question is rather whether Dumont has succeeded in getting that map," he returned, equally low. For, as yet, they had nothing of that nature to guide them on their way to the coast, though they had for some days been trying to buy a smuggled map from a fellow prisoner. "Yet, map or no map, we must start on Monday, because of Marwin's being on sentry duty that night. His next turn is 10 days later, and by that time the moon will be full." "Oh, Dumont knows the canals, of course," said Clary doubtfully, "because he was brought by water from Lynn. But we cannot use them except as rough guides. it would not do to follow them closely. "Oh, I expect he will succeed in getting the map out of Parisot in the end," observed Raoul. "And Parisot never intended to use it himself. And, fortunately for us, Dumont is pretty flush of cash." "Yes, the old pirate, I think," said Lieutenant Clary, "that when I reach France, I shall resign my commission and ship on board a privateer." "Oh, talking of privateers, I hear that some of the men in Caserne No. 4, who are mostly sailors and privateersmen, are getting rather out of hand, and Captain Hanwell has stopped the whole block from selling their wares at the market next week. As a consequence, more unruliness, and he threatens to get the worst black sheep sent to the hulks." "Oh, poor devils," said Raoul. "Ah, there's the postman." A turnkey with a leather bag had just come through from the superintendent's office, which was not far away. Clary got up and went toward the crowd, of which the man immediately became the center. After a moment, Raoul followed him, more because he snatched at anything which relieved the tedium of captivity than because he was any longer expecting a letter, and he waited, only half attending, on the outskirts of the group. To his surprise, he heard his name called and elbowed his way through the throng to find himself staring, with somewhat quickened pulses, at a letter bearing the Wanfield postmark. The handwriting was a lady's. He slipped back to his bench, his heart now beating really hard. The letter had, of course, been already opened, and it was from Miss Forrest. He read, "Dear Monsieur de Sablière, I do not know how to write to you. I know the truth now, in spite of the measures which have been used to keep me in the dark, and which did keep me in that condition until yesterday. No words of mine can express the shame, the burning indignation, which fill me. I implore you to believe that I knew nothing of the duplicity which has sent you to such an unmerited captivity. I did not utter the lie which I find has been attributed to me. On the contrary, I gave that evening an exact recital of what had occurred in Folly Copse and of your gallant behavior there. Yet, from the sequel, you must have been convinced that I had shielded myself at your expense. Oh, believe me, such an idea never entered my mind. Would that it had never entered another's. I'm not, however, wasting my time in idle lamentations. I am determined that this intolerable injustice shall be repaired, and that you shall be liberated as soon as possible. I'm writing to my father to ask him to use all his influence with the transport office. Mr. Bannister, on the strength of my evidence, has already communicated both with the commissioners and with Norman Cross. Meanwhile, also, I am seeing to it that all Wanfield knows how unjustly you have been punished. Mr. Bannister's relief is great to find that you are what he always thought you. Mr. Bentley's and his daughter's, likewise. I do not think the two latter ever doubted it, nor did I, in my heart, though circumstances had been made to look very black against you. How strangely enough, it was your returning of Rasselas, a proceeding which cut me at the moment, as showing, I thought, your opinion of me, which led to the discovery of the truth. I have only this to ask of you, monsieur, that you will keep up your spirits and your patience, and believe that she who, as she sadly feels, is really responsible for the wrong which has been inflicted on you, is doing her utmost to procure its reparation. Your friend, Juliana Forrest. Postscript. Since you will hear it when you return, as I trust you will return, to Wanfield, I think it better to inform you now that my engagement is at an end. Raoul leant against the stockade and put his hand for a moment over his eyes. Now that what he had hoped for, and then ceased to hope for, had really happened, he felt almost bewildered. The ordeal was over. He was cleared, and his friends at Wanfield need no longer be ashamed of him. And Miss Forrest had never told even that venial lie. Oh, generous girl, to act, to write as she had done, since he had never for a moment believed that she would have sacrificed him knowingly. He had afterward regretted that, and piqued and sore as he was at being so unjustly used, he had given way, on leaving Wanfield, to a hasty and not very intelligible impulse, and thrust Rasselas into Lamotte's hands with that message. But now, it seemed, by its results, that his rather unworthy little action had been happily inspired. It was that, evidently, which had led her to make inquiries, to find out that Sir Francis... But here Raoul suddenly sat down on the bench, and Juliana's letter fluttered to the trodden earth of the prison enclosure. He had never fully thought out what, to a girl of the disposition which he attributed to Miss Forrest, might be the result of discovering that her betrothed had stooped to a baseness and a malignity really incredible in a gentleman. Well, now he knew what it had meant, and his breath was somewhat taken away by the knowledge. He bent down, picked up the letter, and reread the postscript. There was no doubt of it. She had broken her marriage over this business. It had changed the course of her whole future life. As a Frenchman, accustomed to the extremely binding nature of a French betrothal, and the difficulties of untying it, Raoul was a little horrified. Her discovery of the truth had certainly been bought at a heavy price. No, his thought changed. And no price could be too heavy to save a woman of upright instincts from marrying a man capable of what Sir Francis Mulholland had shown himself capable of. Miss Forrest was, in the event, fortunate in her escape, and in this country, with her position and her looks, she would have no lack of other suitors. And he doubted whether, from what he had seen, she would cry her eyes out for the lover whom she had so promptly dismissed. Yet, what an upheaval! He sat, with the letter in his hands, staring unseeingly at the hated contours of block number 8, not spending any thoughts, even thoughts of triumph, on the situation which must now be Mulholland's at Wanfield, but thinking solely of the girl. Yes, she would soon console herself, with a better match, even. Some rich English lord, no doubt. He gave a quick sigh, and put the letter carefully into his pocket. As he did so, Raoul saw the large form of Captain Dumont tacking toward him. Captain Dumont had a little of the pirate about his appearance, and was reported to display on emergency the class of temper and linguistic acquirements indispensable, no doubt, to one of his calling. But his usual bearing was that of the typically bluff and jovial seaman. He was one of the few officers there who were not broke paroles. As the Indienne, at least when captured, carried less than 14 guns, her captain was not entitled to the privilege of parole, from which, indeed, he had self-sacrificingly cut himself off by throwing 3 overboard to prevent them from falling into the hands of the enemy. He now winked a blue eye set, as to its outer corner, amid innumerable creases, and said cheerfully, "A fine morning, de Sabliac. Who had a letter? A lucky dog. Oh, we're all in luck, for I have got it. So." He rolled on, repeating the wink. The unfinished sentence meant, "There's now nothing to keep us back from Monday's venture." But Raoul remained staring after him without moving or replying. He had quite forgotten that he was to escape the day after tomorrow. But to try to escape now would be insanity. More, it would be ingratitude. Yet, could he withdraw at the 11th hour? He got up at last from the bench with a face vastly more troubled for all the advent of Juliana Forrest's letter than that with which he had watched his cloud an hour ago. That evening, in their close little sleeping apartment, he soon learnt from his comrades that he could not withdraw. The idea of the escape taking place without him was received by them with incredulity, with consternation, and then with an indignation which, in Captain Dumont's case, began very soon to warm into anger. And Clary was not conciliatory. "And so," he exclaimed, "you are content to wait while strings are pulled for you. or to wait indefinitely, perhaps forever. Oh, what has come to you, de Sabliac? Oh, I'm not afraid, if that is what you are thinking, retorted Raoul, firing up a little. I've told you exactly the position I'm in. Was it so difficult to understand? No, said Dumont starkly. It's not. Everyone for his own skin, and I'll call no man white-livered, unless he has given better cause for it than a natural wish to care for that. But there are two of us, and only one of you, Captain de Sabliac, and I reckon two skins are worth more than one. Or, perhaps, seeing that you're a noble by birth, and we ain't, you count it quits, me and Lieutenant Claret against you. Oh, you know I think nothing of the sort, Captain Dumont, answered Raoul hotly. And my birth has nothing to do with the matter. Oh, come, put in Claret pacifically. All this is off the point. I'm sure that if de Sabliac thinks it over. How thinks it over? He don't need to. Why, I believe, damn my eyes, said Captain Dumont with an angry laugh, that neither of you youngsters has seen the real reason why we must have him, willing or unwilling. He's the only one of us who speaks English. And when, by the way in which both young men gazed blankly at him, the master of the Andienne saw that he was right, he slapped his knee with delight, and the threatened simoon blew over. I've got you there, young fellow, he said to the recalcitrant fugitive, and slapped him next. Oh, you can't back out, when you know that Claret and I might just as well lie snug in our beds on Monday night as start through two English counties without you to do the parleying. Yes, said Raoul, swallowing down with as good a grace as he could his irritation and disappointment. Yes, you've certainly got me there. I confess I never thought of that point. Of course, I will come, and willingly. Forget that I ever proposed anything else. Captain Dumont made a large gesture. It is already forgotten, he said magnanimously. And if you supply the lingo, de Sabliac, I can supply a fist. He doubled that formidable object as he spoke. Which will not, I hope, be required, put in Claret quickly. And the last weapon we want to employ, Captain, is violence. It is a very undiplomatic one in the hands of a fugitive. Oh, you wait, my lad, till you are in need of it, and you won't think it undiplomatic then. Well, this little matter being settled, I shall turn in. Claret lingered a moment by Raoul's bed as the latter also began to undress. Oh, you know, he said, in a low voice, it is really much better, for your own sake, to come with us. And there have been other cases here for whom representations have been made to the transport board. Poor Mazat, for instance, he's been waiting nearly 3 years for their result. Raoul at this moment was pulling his shirt over his head and made no immediate answer. When he emerged, he said briefly, I've no doubt you're right. At any rate, I am coming with you. It was the question of a letter to Miss Forrest, not this imminent adventure, which chiefly engaged his thoughts next day. He could write and thank her, it was true, but he could not possibly say the thing he wanted to say, that, ungrateful and foolish as he must appear, he was only carrying out this escape because he was already committed to it, for in a letter which would be read by the authorities, he could obviously make no reference, even veiled, to a project of flight. In the end, he decided that he would wait to write until he was clear of Norman Cross. But it was plain that he would never see Juliana Forrest's face again. Reinstatement and release, such as she was working for, might have meant return to Wanfield, but successful escape meant leaving England altogether. And unsuccessful would mean Norman Cross forever, or removal to another prison, and perhaps to one of the big new depots in Scotland, Valleyfield or Perth. If he were retaken, he would certainly never be allowed out again on parole while his captivity lasted. Yet, the more he knew that it was impossible, the more keen was his desire to see her once more, not only to thank her from his heart for what she had done, not only to ask her to let him have back as a memento really to be kept this time, that book which, indirectly, had been the cause of everything. But just for the sake of seeing her. Yes, he would like to talk to Juliana Forrest once again. Not by the stream. In the garden at Northover, where they had spoken once or twice, when the daffodils were out under the cedars. He wondered what flowers were blooming there now. How one knew nothing of flowers here. He would like to see the garden at Northover again, and now he never would. But at this point, Raoul pulled himself up. He, a soldier, regretting his captivity because it had been pleasant. He was indeed growing soft. Here, with a chance before him of breathing once more the air of France, he was sentimentally thinking of the charms of England, and of an Englishwoman. Oh, but surely he had the right to wish to thank her who had championed him, and the most fervid Anglophobe could not blame him for that desire. The chosen day, Monday, dawned at last. Raoul, waking early, looked in the dim light at his sleeping companions, and wondered where they would all be by next morning, if they were all three still alive. It was quite on the cards that one of them would get a bullet through the head, for the sentries were numerous, and armed with ball cartridge. It was a day of tension for all of them, and passed with cruel slowness. But it did pass. Dumont was unusually noisy and cheerful at supper, the more so that there was a rumour going about that the sentries were likely to be doubled that night in the vicinity of Caserne No. 4, the mutinous block, and he thought that in consequence the officers' quarters might be less closely guarded. But Raoul and Claret pointed out that the brigade major, who, and not the agent superintendent, was responsible for the military arrangements of the prison, a dual control not always of the most happy, had plenty of men to post as extra sentries. And if he did withdraw any from their corner of the depot, might not Marwin conceivably be one of them? If so, what of the rope for which he had made himself responsible? 5 hours later, when they were actually stealing in the dark along the ditch at the foot of the great wall, that was indeed the vital question. To Raoul, the foremost, feeling vainly along the brickwork for that indispensable adjunct, it seemed a cruel irony to be balked at the last stage of all, after having overcome their other difficulties. After having squeezed through the ventilator, climbed safely down the rickety pipe outside the caserne and over the pointed palisade, and after having avoided, more by luck than skill, the many sentries posted between it and the wall. And then, suddenly, his hand encountered what he sought. It was a good stout rope, knotted at intervals. He gave it a hard tug. It seemed securely fastened to something on the other side, and in a whisper, Raoul communicated this information to his comrades. It had been arranged that he was to go last, because, being the lightest, he would probably have least difficulty in swarming up the rope when its end was free, so he was first to steady it for his heavier companions. As the wall was only 9 feet high on its outer side, its greater height on the inner being due to the excavation of the fosse at its base, the fugitives, once up, could drop the distance. Dumont, the sailor, went first, and had soon arrived at the top, in spite of his corpulence. Yet, dark as the night was, his bulk seemed to Raoul to be plainly visible against the sky on the crest of the wall, and his arrival on the ground the other side was announced by a rather telltale thud. Claret followed quickly. His drop was inaudible. And then Raoul went up, the rope spinning as he climbed, straddled the wall, saw their upturned faces very dimly below him, and dropped lightly beside them. There was no sign of Marwin, nor, at the moment, of any of his comrades. Oh, surely some sentries had been removed. "Don't wait," whispered Raoul, his mouth at Claret's ear. "I will overtake you in a moment. I promise not to leave the rope about." He hauled the slack over the wall to him, and, as the others vanished, stooped to feel in the darkness how the end was secured at its foot. he could easily have cut it off without ascertaining this, but in that case the knot, remaining, might perhaps bring complicity home to Marwin. A serious business for a sentry. Moreover, he had given his word. Oh, confound the fellow! Whatever was this he had fastened it to, right down in the grass at the base of the wall? The essential need of haste made Raoul's fingers clumsy. He would have to cut the rope, after all. Kneeling on one knee, he put his hand into his pocket for a small knife which he had contrived to retain in spite of regulations. And the next instant was almost blinded by the glare of a suddenly opened lantern. End of section 7.